Welcome to the Startup Grind.
We got a lot of new people. Welcome to Startup Grind. Startup Grind is a worldwide event that's happening. It's a Google-backed entrepreneur on platform. We usually have a banner right here, but I'm just going to have Ryan, wherever Ryan's at, the other Ryan, he's going to come up here and just say Startup Grind every now. There he is. He's just going to come up and there you go. That's the branding for the evening. But how many people, if this is your first visit, went on the Startup Grind website and did some exploration? Raise your hand. Actually went on the Startup Grind website and actually explored the site and kind of saw what it was all about. It's all about connecting the entrepreneurial community, the startup community, in a way where you can actually build meaningful relationships. So out of everything, even after the talk, when you get that moment of time, meet new people, exchange business cards, make sure that you're authentically meeting people, because that's what it's really all about. So we can build the entrepreneurial ecosystem that Tallahassee truly deserves. How many people believe that Tallahassee deserves an awesome entrepreneurial ecosystem? Clap it up if you do. We talk about it, but this is it. This is it growing up right now. So without further ado, what we're gonna do is go ahead and bring up the speaker for the day. How many people know this guy? Raise your hand. Clap it up for him if you know him. This is Ryan Kopinsky. This guy right here, I met him some time ago, and when I met him, I knew that he was going to be one of Tallahassee's revolutionaries because of the way that he was thinking. He was so far advanced in the things that he saw for Tallahassee. I said, it's only going to be a matter of time before this guy is a breakout guy, a linchpin for the city. And then when he broke out with Google Glass, I said, okay, game over. He's the only guy really, really talking about Google Glass in a really relevant, powerful way. And that inspired me. I said, we are actually getting some of the top talent right here in Tallahassee doing great things. And that's this guy, Ryan Kopinsky. So without further ado, let's bring up Ryan Kopinsky. And you got a partner. And he's got a partner. He's got a sidekick in crime that's doing good things with Google Glass as well. And he's on his way. And so when he comes in, I just want everybody just like boo like one time. Is that cool? I'm serious. When he come in, just like boo, like real loud, let him know that you're booing him. And before he even gets his mic, just boo him real good. Can we agree to that? You can just shake your head. You ain't got to put yourself on blast. Just shake your head. Just like that. Okay.
So just a disclaimer, John Perkins is also the co-founder of ShopX, along with me. And the reason why he's not here, he has a family matter. And I am just starting a family, but he has a full-blown family. So hey, you know, family before startups. But he's done an awesome job at helping me out, so.
You see, ain't he a nice guy? He's a nice guy. I wouldn't have did that, but it's all good. It's all good. So what we're going to do is go ahead and get started. I think my notebook is up there, if Shelby. Yep, grab that for me, bring it up here. I had the opportunity to sit down with Ryan before the event and really kind of dig into his mind because he's working on a lot of stuff. And I didn't want to miss anything. So if y'all see me up here with my cheat sheet, it's because I'm cheating. Y'all can boo that. Boo it, boo. This is practice. So we're going to just go ahead and just dive right in and start talking about the story of glass. That's something that we really want to talk about because glass is one of Google's newest technologies. It's really, really, it's coming up under a lot of firestorm.
Yes. With any new technology that's disruptive, there's always going to be a positive wave and a negative wave. And people really do it just to ride a wave, whether it's positive or negative. But I try to embrace it as opposed to just bash it. I consider myself an early adopter. And glass has really opened up my eyes what technology, you know.
Like no pun intended.
No pun intended. But honestly, it's a lot of people see it as I'm recording you. The battery won't even last me spying on you. But the amount of stuff that glass has the potential to do is really remarkable.
Yeah, and I think we talked a little bit about that. So when you think about glass, what context, because I think that's part of it, like thinking about glass in the right context, right? Not looking at it, okay, that's a way for you to spy on me. What's the best way to, like, what's your context? How do you look at glass?
So the way I see glass is, it's not only, it's really the Iron Man that really inspired the whole HUD display, and fighter jets already have that, and BMWs already have a heads-up display. And the neat thing about it is you can focus on what you're doing using your hands while technology is just helping you out along the way. And that's what it really is supposed to be. And our phones, as soon as you walk with your phone and you're texting, you're completely disconnected. And the phones have to connect us to the world. So glass really enables you to do that in a unique way.
So you never think about spying on people, right? Be honest.
I have too much to do to do
okay.
that.
Okay. I just wanted to throw that out there.
No interest.
Okay, are you sure?
Yes, very sure.
Are you spying on me right now?
No, okay. I'm not recording you.
All right, I just want to make sure.
So when you first got into glass, you were a pioneer here locally. You were a pioneer in this area. You were one of how many people who had glass in Tallahassee?
When I bought glass, I think I was either the first one or the second one. And I think right now there's a maximum of 5 to 6 people that I know of.
In Tallahassee as
well? Yes. So if they're early adopters, I know of them. Okay. And it's not a lot of them. And I should really mention this. John McFarlane from TalSearch, he was one of the people that believed in me early on.
Yeah.
And he helped sponsor my Google Glass.
Yeah.
And look where I am right now. So I really appreciate the people believing in me, such as John McFarlane and the people at Domi. It's just, I was a rookie and they believed.
Can we clap that up for just 1 second? I think that's one part. That is so cool. That is so cool. I think that's one thing that I learned about Tallahassee when I first got here. People will embrace you. Like, if you're really about to do something awesome, they will embrace you so they can see that awesome happen. And I know McFarlane, he's always on the edge. Like, Vince, what's going on? What's going on, Vince? So I know he's one of the players. And then when Domi came along, you got Micah and his whole crew. I knew that Tallahassee was about to get like a jump start and really start doing awesome stuff. So when I talk about jump start, you actually developed an application for Google Glass, took it to Google, and got in the marketplace. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
So it wasn't as easy, and it was really funny because it was one night where, as a coder, it's sometimes hard to come up with ideas. So we were here late at night, Micah, his wife, and a few other designers and coders. And I asked them, what app would you like to use that can affect your daily life? And there were some, I think, 15 ideas or something, but a lot of people liked the idea of a to-do list or a shopping list. And I said, okay, I'm gonna do a quick demo just to see how many people in the actual glass community would enjoy something like that. And in 2 weeks' time, 300 people signed up for something that hasn't even existed yet at that point. So I said, okay, we're gonna go for it.
Oh, that's really, really cool. So basically, you had to come up with the idea, and you said, okay, we're about to go make it, and it's called ShopX.
Right.
How many people have ShopX like right now?
So it's 1,700 plus. I think the actual number is like 750 something. No, okay. 1,750 something.
1,750 something.
And it's interesting because it's worldwide. Glass is only sold right now in the US and the UK, but I'm seeing Russian shopping items and Japanese and some languages I don't even know what it is. So it's really interesting to see how technology I've never created an app just had affected people that I don't even know. Speak languages that I don't even know what it means. It's just awesome.
Yeah, I think it's really awesome that this is happening right here in Tallahassee.
Made in Tallahassee with love. You know,
with love. How many people have websites in this room? Raise your hand. Because I noticed that like Ryan Bonhart on his website, he always puts on the bottom Made in Tallahassee with a little heart. I think that's cool. Yeah. I didn't do it. I'm ridiculous like that. But he actually did it, which is awesome. And I think that the more we do in Tallahassee and really, really make those marks, I think that's important. So thank you for making a big mark on that. We talked a little bit about a disruptive technology. Google Glass is a disruptive technology. Why do you see it as a disruptive technology? Give me your definition of disruptive technology as it pertains to Google Glass.
So first of all, it's a computer on your face. Period. I mean, that is like sci-fi coming into reality. And what people really don't understand is when they see it on my face, then it just, some people ask me if it's a medical device. But when you use it and you get used to it, I have some shades that don't have glass on, and I tap on the sides because I expect glass to be there. Now, when technology can change your behavior that it's a habit,
yeah.
That is disruptive.
Yes.
So it's just remarkable what they did. And it may look a bit weird, mm-hmm. but they're working with Ray-Ban and Oakley and other partners that make it look fashionable.
Right,
exactly. And I think you just tapped on something that's really, really interesting. Where's Jim Hunt? Jim Hunt is in the house. Jim Hunt brought an idea to me some time ago, behavior-based innovation. In other words, what are the new behaviors that we have now that we didn't have, let's just say 3 years ago, that we could actually build technology on top of? So do you feel like Google Glass is creating a completely different new set of behaviors that we have as individuals that can be built on top of? Like, so for instance, you want to tap like that. I don't tap my glasses like.
I think it really has to do with some form of new etiquette. Because when the internet first came out, people had to really learn how to brand themselves, if you will, to not have any bad people come after them. And what glass really did was open the people's eyes up that there can be a camera on you at any point in time, and there already is. So if I'm not looking at you, there are cameras on you for your safety and sometimes for spying. But what glass does, it's make us aware that anyone at this point can be watching you, so you better behave. And I think that behavior by itself is just, you know, walking in a public restroom with glass on, I do this and I put it on my head. It looks weird. But because there's not a norm yet, you're trying to shape it.
Trying to shape what that norm could become. That's pretty awesome. And another thing that we talked a little bit about was like niche markets. Mm-hmm. Let's start digging into this whole idea of niche markets. Can you talk to me about that a little bit?
So I don't see glass right now being a widespread consumer device just because of its price point. It's $1,500 starting off. And then if you want frames, it's another $200. It's really expensive.
Can we pause? How many people in this room, if you have $1,500 to spend, you would spend it on Google Glass? Raise your hand.
Okay, that's
so we have you have a few people.
That's
now, raise your hand if you wouldn't spend it. Okay. And I'm just going to pick on one person. Okay, raise your hand again. Yeah, you're about to get put on blast. Gregor, why wouldn't you spend $1,500 on Google Glass? Just curious.
I'll let the beta testers do their thing first. I'll come in generation 4.
Okay, raise hands again, those who wouldn't. You right there, why wouldn't you buy it? Yeah, you. Mm-hmm, that's you.
I kind of agree with, I don't really know enough about it.
Okay, so it's about awareness.
It's like when a cell phone comes out, everyone goes out and gets a new iPhone, and then, oh, it's got all these glitches, and then I would be the person that would get it, you know, Black Friday when it goes on sale.
Hey, he said, I'm getting on Black Friday.
Someone else
makes sense.
Me about it,
okay, and you are doing a lot of blogging, right? Are you doing a lot of blogging around awareness for Google X? Because I think that's part of it.
Yeah, so I try to raise awareness in a way where people understand its potential. So, it's really important to know that, yes, glass is not it's not perfect right now, but the potential. Just imagine, for example, a scenario. A firefighter is going into a building that's on fire. He has the blueprint of the building overlaid on his vision. So now he already knows way more than just blindly running into the smoke.
Yes.
Now he knows where the fire started. So he knows most likely how to extinguish it the best way. He can see if there are some people still in the building that he has to rescue that have priority. All of that on your phone, I mean, that would not work because you have all this stuff to carry.
Mm-hmm.
So all of a sudden, you add context to people's lives that in that situation, that's a niche application that I really see has a lot of potential.
Yeah.
So maybe not every user is going to use it. Maybe he's not going to buy it until Gen 4.
Mm-hmm.
But to experiment with those use cases, I think it's highly valuable.
Absolutely, I think so too. And you talked to me a little bit earlier about like even like police. So we talked about fire, you got police. What about medical architecture? Can you see that as well?
So medical, it's kind of an obvious industry because what they're doing already is they're streaming surgeries so students can learn while it's happening. Architects, surveying, blueprints. I think those industries, people don't realize how they can disrupt those industries with that technology. They really don't understand the potential yet, and it's about education.
Right, how many technologists do we have in the room? People who are like deep into technology, raise your hand. Because we got candy makers and everything in the room, so I just want to see the tech people. Okay, because from a technology standpoint, I get excited. It was just this morning, I'm gonna be honest, it was like just this morning that the light came on for me because I'm driving next to a police and he's sitting there on his computer. I'm like, they telling me not to text and drive and he's full-blown computing. Yeah, clap that up. Clap that up. Like, you're going to, like, full-blown compute. But it would be really, really cool if he had Google Glass and he could actually do the same types of searches or whatever he's doing just with voice and being able to actually see that overlay.
I think even for safety, because police officers right now already have a camera. So they record everything that you're saying to them. And they have a microphone. And it's mostly for the safety, but also for a record. So what Google Glass will do is it'll give you what the police is seeing, that's what's going to be recorded.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's a computer, so you can search a license plate. You can search before you even go to the car. You already know way more than you would know with just the computer search. Because the computer search, if you've seen the UI, I've seen it, it's from the 80s.
Oh, wow.
They still use keyboard and arrow, and everything is manual, no voice command. Even voice command by itself is so valuable.
Wow.
Because then you can use your hands and you can do a lot more stuff.
Right. So the disruptor might be in this room. One of you technologists, write the program for the police and get with Ryan so you can make it happen. Put it on the deal. I'm just saying, idea. Let's talk about the story of ShopX. We talked a little bit about ShopX, but I think it's important for people, especially in the startup culture, to understand kind of the process you went through to go, because we found out how you got the idea, but we don't know nothing about how you got it to Google or any of those other things that are really, really important to the process.
So it's a lot of hard work. So when people see ShopX, and I'm in the Tallahassee Democrat, they don't really see what's happening behind the scenes. Enrique over there and some of my other friends, Thomas, they see me code late at night, and they see like the background, what is really happening on the back end. And it's a lot of hard work, but it's rewarding. ShopX has been blogged about in Spain, Italy, France when it launched on launch day. We were featured on major tech blogs. Wow. And this is out of Tallahassee.
Yeah.
But the actual process meant 2 months of emailing with Google back and forth. This design doesn't work. This is not the right font. This is not the right font size. They really want it perfect. Why? Because there's already so much negative press. They really want to have whatever is on glass to be perfect. And I'm not saying that ShopX is perfect, but we worked really hard to make it up to Google standards.
So we worked really hard.
We worked really hard, and we were the 52nd app to be accepted for their platform. And just to put it in perspective.
Yeah, clap that up.
You'll get it. Next week.
Here we go. Here we go.
And to put it in perspective, iPhone has 1.2 million apps. So to really shine on iPhone or Android is really hard. But if you put in the work for Google Glass, all of a sudden, you know, two guys from Tallahassee can do it.
Yeah, because that's a benchmark right there. I mean, number 52 that was approved through that rigorous process that Google will put you through. Absolutely. So the users are the personas that use ShopX. What kind of tone, what kind of feel? Because we talked a little bit about niche. Now here we are with ShopX. What is the persona or the user profile, the people that use ShopX?
So our average user is really the San Francisco type of user that is really active, makes a good salary, gluten-free diets, organic stuff. So it's the people that can afford glass in the first place, but it's also the people that are really conscious about technology and a healthy lifestyle. So when creating a product like ShopX, that's really your target audience, and you really have to build a UX that supports that. You cannot just build for everyone because you can't please everyone.
Right. ShopX have a blog? I haven't checked it out. Does ShopX have a blog in itself?
So it does have a blog, but I kind of changed it to my blog because maintaining two blogs is just too much of a hassle. Mm-hmm. But yes, anyone that wants to even meet with me just to talk about the story and maybe do a Google Glass app, I'll be happy to do so.
Okay, because I mean, instantly when you started talking about the fusion between those people who are really, really conscious about their eating and their dieting, so on and so forth, and using ShopX to augment, you know, that process, I think that's a huge market all into itself. Just again, another idea. I throw that out there. let's jump gears a little bit and talk a little bit about, does everybody kind of have a foundational understanding of glass at this point? Clap it up if you do, because I don't want to move too fast. I will dig and dig and dig if we got to. But another thing that I found that is really, really interesting about, right, you have a deep passion for Tallahassee and this ecosystem that we're trying to build. Let's talk a little bit about that. Give me an insight, your perspective of the Tallahassee ecosystem.
I think what's really nice about Tallahassee, I came here 7 years ago from Suriname, South America. Most of you probably don't know where that is. It was a Dutch colony, half a million people, so very small. Awesome, you know where it is.
He said, you know.
Awesome. So it was really humbling that, you know, being an outsider, I could still shine as an individual. Really early on, Tallahassee was embracing the uniqueness of individuals. And if you go to a city like Silicon Valley, or that's not a city, but like a place, or Austin, it's really your number. And you're trying to, you know, climb up, but it's hard because everyone is climbing up.
Yeah.
If you find your niche in Tallahassee, it's fairly easy to shine.
Yeah.
For now.
There we go. Yeah. I'll say clap that up as well. You know, I'm sitting here, I'm like, eyes getting bigger as he's going, because that is so true. That's something that when I moved here 4 years ago, I recognized as well, is Tallahassee is like a canvas. It's a clear canvas that if you really have something that you're passionate about, you can actually shine and like make a difference and like kill it. And that's what you've done. And I bet you there's people in this room right now that have that same potential and possibility. So I just want to kind of put a pin in that. Yeah, I want to put a pin in that. The Tallahassee has a lot of room for a lot of awesomeness. And I know that awesomeness, a big chunk of it, is right here in this room. And so I want to make sure that we understand that piece. Again, that's another. Yeah, you say it. Mm-hmm. He said it back there. The size of the market, and this whole idea that size does matter. It does matter. When it comes to an entrepreneurial ecosystem, the size does matter. Tallahassee being a little bit more compact right now, still in its budding stages. Give me three benefits that you've gotten out of being in this market, above and beyond being able to shine. Give me three other benefits that you've gotten out of being in this ecosystem in its starting phases right now.
I'm not sure if I can say three of the bat, but what I will say is that if you're on a canvas, this is really a clean canvas, or very early on in a stage, you can help mold it. And your vision, you can really put your vision to work. So anyone that has a passion, I mean, those guys that are doing e-bikes right there, electric bikes, yeah. I mean, no one is doing that in Tallahassee, so you can really have a meaningful product that you put in a market, and it's just amazing how much opportunity there is in Tallahassee, and we have to stop apologizing for Tallahassee. We just have to be proud of it. Yes, we're not Silicon Valley, but we shouldn't be.
Right. Tallahassee has its own DNA.
Yeah, we're Tallahassee.
he's like reminding me, yeah, we're Tallahassee. I get it, yeah. You gotta remind me. No, I was kidding. Tallahassee support. Like, early you talked about McFarland, how he came over the top, and he was supportive. I felt the exact same thing, that Tallahassee does have a very strong support system. People like Jason Stamm comes to the table, Jim Hunt comes to the table. I mean, my whole team, if I think about the people who have been here on the ground and how they, like, wrap around you and you just kind of, like, fall in, it's like 4 years later, like, what the heck? Tallahassee is pretty awesome as far as supporting. Can you talk a little bit about Tallahassee support?
It's an interesting story. The reason why John Perkins' other team is because I was struggling with a cloud platform. I wanted to have ShopX that anyone can sync their shopping list on the cloud, so if your device goes off or whatever, you still have it. And he came over to my apartment. Instead of being with his family, he came over and he said, okay, I'm gonna help you, just set it up. And he was really passionate. He was coding. And I was like, this guy is so passionate for something that I am passionate about as well. So just the people that are in Tallahassee, for example, Domi, you know, it's a nice space. It's really awesome. I don't think there's anything like that in Tallahassee. But it's not the space that matters to me. It's like the awesome nights that I spent with Thomas playing video games and building stuff and 3D printing stuff. And with Enrique talking about his brand and stuff. It's really the people and the community.
Yeah.
Talking to Micah, bouncing off ideas, and then he makes a joke. It's literally the people in Tallahassee that make it what it is.
Absolutely. How many people in this room actually work inside of Domi Station? Raise your hand. Your Domi Station people. Okay. You said we're all back. There we all back here. We all back here packed up. And if you're not in Domi Station, I just kind of want to hear some of the other places that people are. If you have, raise your hand if you're a startup that you're not in Domi Station. Raise your hand. Okay. Where are you at? I already know where you at, Maurice. I come and see you every morning getting that coffee. And I know where you at with the candy, too. I mean, some of the other startups, like, where are some of the other places that you're kind of stacked up at?
I work at home.
You work from home?
With Jack, okay.
Home. What else we got? Any other cool places?
Scholarship.
That's what's up. What else we got?
Yeah, I work at home, and then I work on site, too.
Okay. Home and site. Okay, cool, because this is where I plug Domi. If you don't have, like, a home to, like, crush it, the thing that I've heard about Domi is, like, if you come here, you're going to crush it because the people around you are crushing it. So I'm just putting a tag out there. Again, that's again, another idea. I don't know. Domi, it's just write that one down. But serious, Domi is a really, really cool place. And again, it is the people that are inside of Domi that makes it awesome. They let us do Startup Grind here. We got to clap that up. I got to get that on tape. Got that on tape. That's it. And this will be the home of Startup Grind from now until they kick us out. Yeah, because I do stuff, so I don't know. No, seriously, this will be the home for Startup Grind, and I'm happy to be here because I feel the exact same thing. The energy is awesome. How would you advise a person? Because we talked a little bit about ideas, and you kind of pumped up back there. You got kind of wild. Yeah, you got pretty excited about it. What advice would you give the people in this room that have ideas and just haven't jumped out there yet?
ShopX was the first app that I worked on, and I didn't know anything about Ruby on Rails, which is built on. So don't be afraid to start something that you don't even know how it's going to end. Quite frankly, I wanted an experiment to learn how to code for glass, and all of a sudden, Italy is blogging about ShopX, right? So it gets out of hand in a good way. So don't be afraid to start. If you fail, I mean, come on, you're young. And even for the people that are older, who cares? You learn from your mistakes. Don't make too many, but you learn from them. So just start it. I'm going to say this. Nike shouldn't sue me. Just do it. Please don't sue me.
Can we edit that?
Please
can
don't sue
me. Edit that.
Yeah, edit that out.
I'm just kidding. I thought that was cool. He's just, not going to edit it. It's going to be there. We'll get in trouble later. Ask for permission. So how many people in this room actually have an idea and you just haven't jumped out there yet? Don't be shy. Raise your hand. Because we got a process for you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We got a process. That thing we talked about. But after this, we take them back there. They're going to start something. They're going to start something. No, seriously. Tallahassee, if I can throw this in there, Tallahassee is looking for really, really great ideas. It's looking for its revolutionaries. It's looking for the people who are willing to jump out there and do something. So everything Ryan is saying up here, write that thing down. If you don't have a pad, think about it. And then as soon as you put it on your phone, do something. Start. That one word, start. Just get out there and get busy, and you will find the support and the help that you need to get something off the ground. And that's pretty much all I've got for you. Is there anything else that you really want to bring to the forefront before we start asking? Where's your partner at?
He's at home with his family, unfortunately.
We keep talking about that. What we keep, don't you clap? Don't you clap? No, that is good business, though.
He's an awesome person. Quite frankly, I couldn't have wished for a better co-founder.
That's what I'm talking about. And you know what was really funny, and it's no surprise that Jason Stamm, my business partner, would clap that up, because like in the beginning of our partnership, that's what we talked about first, like family's always first. So that's a good thing. So I am not knocking it, but we are going to boo him when we see him. I'm just saying, I'm a boo him. Before the record, I'm a boo him. I'm just kidding. But really, what I want to do right now is just take this time to kind of open up the floor for questions. You guys can toss questions up here, whatever you got, and we're going to try to answer them. Is that cool?
Cool with me.
You good back there on the mics? Everything's good? Let's get it.
I'm curious what the business model is.
The business model for... Okay, cool.
You're asking the hardest question first. Okay. The business model is start something great and see where it goes. We're losing money right now, and I'm not really seeking investor money because it's not that at that stage yet. But it's really an experiment that I see as, if I'm paying more than $30,000 a year for a university, I can pay $200 a month to learn something at a startup. So it's more of an investment. I'm investing in my own future. And if we make money, whoop-de-doo. But we are exploring ways to utilize glass to make money. One thing that is keeping us from that is that every glassware, which is a Google Glass application, has to be free on My Glass, which is the app store for Google Glass. So you can't sell it, but you can have some premium features. For example, for a shopping list, you can have the iLocation or coupons or instant deals type of thing that are premium. So you have the freemium model. So we are exploring it, but right now we're more focused on finding our target audience and really perfecting the UX of it.
Wow, that's really cool.
So you say the apps have to be free, but say like you've got a surgery center that wants to utilize it and they develop in-house stuff, can they not utilize it the way they want to and collect and utilize it?
So in-house you can do a lot, and actually Glass just introduced Work for Glass and Good for Glass, those names are right. But it's basically, so the Good for Glass is for charity, where Google gives you $25,000 to do something for good. And then for Work is certified work glassware. And to my knowledge, is you can use it as much as you want. There's no restrictions on it. You just won't be able to make it available to consumers. But it is possible to do it in-house.
Just to follow up on that question, sure. So you could make it available to the retail consumer, but could you sell that to other entities like other medical centers or whatever?
So you just don't go through the store for distribution. You come in with your own software and the device.
You would have to manually load every glass, so that's not a convenient way. They have a really nice infrastructure that you can install it within a few seconds. If you do it on your own, then you have to build your own infrastructure, and it kind of defeats the purpose. So maybe in the future you can, but right now they're trying to limit the amount of failures that they can have.
Okay, that makes sense.
The him in the back.
Have you never done anything with anybody else before? Are you background in programming though? I mean,
so I'm a PhD candidate in robotics. So most of my experience is in hardware and software, Java, embedded C, low-level stuff, nothing really on the app level. I know some HTML5 just from hacking. So yes, I'm not really an expert in Ruby on Rails. John Perkins is. He's really good at it. I just learned from him.
Right. Benson Hunt, I'm the one with the jokes and ideas.
Ryan Kopinsky. If you want to look me up, www.ryankopinsky.com. And I'll talk to you afterwards if you want more.
Don't Google me. I'm just saying.
Okay, so let's go here and then we'll go there. Okay.
Okay, so I have a question. Okay. When I was a kid, my dad spent $4,000 on a 386 DX33. So the idea that someone's going to spend $1,500 on Google Glass, I think is very plausible. The thing is, most of the companies that produce the software for that 386, like Interplay and Apogee and all these guys, they're all long gone. So what's your long view? Do you have kind of a grand strategy for how is Glass going to be integrated into society, and how is my business going to, or how's my livelihood going to go forward parallel with Google Glass into the next 10 years or so?
So the way I see it is, Glass by itself may not be here maybe in a year, but just the experience of being in wearable tech early on, just imagine the people that were programming first for iPhone. Those guys are really making big bucks now because they were early on in the ecosystem, so they really, Apple is treating them really well. And Google has been really nice to me, and now they know, Google Ventures knows about us. I mean, It's nice to be early on in the ecosystem. Is it high risk? Absolutely.
Yeah.
So it's really a gamble. I'm willing to do that gamble.
Okay, so you're not even thinking about positioning yourself out there. You're living in the...
My long term is robotics. Okay. That's why I'm doing my PhD in robotics.
Right.
But wearable tech really adds a unique flavor to what you can do with robotics, because wearable tech can collect data that is almost me. Right? It sees what I'm seeing. It hears. Yeah, so you can get unique data that you can add context to, and start doing a lot of stuff with autonomy. That is like a whole different talk. Like we can talk for hours on that.
Level. He's about to take you to the PhD level.
Okay, I think Jason was here, and then
he's
I'll
like,
get you.
We can add content.
Do you know the book Feed by M.T. Anderson, 2002? Anybody? No? All right. So it's I recommend that you check it out. Because it could give you a lot of good ideas on Google Glass. It's a futuristic sci-fi situation. I'm reading it right now, and I'm halfway through it, and here I am, you're talking about Google Glass. And these young people are walking around with constant feeds, essentially connected to the internet in their head, but they're feeds. And they do things like go to the moon to party on spring break and stuff like that. So it's we were just talking about sci-fi and what the sci-fi writers of this generation are doing. And essentially, in 2002, somebody in a sci-fi novel predicted what Google Glass
yes.
would be applied to now. And so I would recommend check out that book, because you might actually find some societal functionality that you're really interested in with your skills and your status in Google. You might actually be able to achieve something that can truly create value for yourself and all of us. I would love to see that.
I will check it out for sure.
So that wasn't even a question. That was like a dialogue. Hey, did anybody get that? Did you read the book? Did you read the book? Okay, let me tell you about it. Here we go. That was pretty awesome. But and we had that that conversation was pretty relevant. You know, the past future, right? When you think about the past future, like you think about Star Trek and all that kind of stuff, and the stuff that we see now, and it's like that stuff is really here.
Startups are really building what sci-fi was like 5 years or 10 years ago. I've seen so much stuff that is like almost copy of, and it's working though, because people like sci-fi stuff. People like to be superheroes. I like Iron Man. I like, you know, having a computer on my face. I like it.
We know because it's right there. He said, I'm just waiting on that laser gun. That's what I'm waiting on. Whoever invents that is going to be off of the chain. What we got?
Brian, what's the situation with regard to future competition with Google Glass? I assume before long there will be other companies with competing technologies.
So after our launch, it took us 4 months from zero to launch. And after our launch, we were 52nd. And then 2 weeks after, there were 10 more in a batch. So it's going to accelerate. And I think right now there's close to 80.
No, I mean the glass itself.
Oh, glass itself?
The iPhone, the Apple Glass.
So it's really a wearable tech kind of thing. There's a lot of smartwatches right now, but Epson, the Moverio, I don't know the model number, is a smart glasses thing. So yes, there is going to be a competition, but as iPhone and iPad has proven, the first to market is usually king because they have a lot of time to perfect it. Hopefully Google doesn't mess that opportunity up.
Just briefly, tactically, in terms of building an app for an Android platform, traditionally an Android platform versus Google Glass, can you compare and contrast? I know you said that there was, you know, obviously a pretty strict regimen on limiting who goes first and kind of the background. Is that bootstrap or what is it the platform that you're going for, and how does it broadly, you know, I know you don't get specific on how they make different.
So there's two ways to program for Glass, or actually three ways. The last one is a hybrid. So the first one is the Mirror API, which is the one that ShopX is using. And it's like a messaging notification platform. So Google really does all the heavy lifting. I make a callback to their server. They handle it for me on Glass, and everything is magic. So that's really the first thing that I would suggest using. Now, if you want low-level access, such as the GPS and controlling the camera, then you really want to be more on the low level, which is the GDK, which is the Glass Development Kit. And that's Android. That is the same Android that you have on your phone, the team, and it's just maybe a scaled-down version of it, but it's an Android ROM, and you program in Android. I think the languages and the tools is not as different as one may think. It's really the mindset of creating an app. Because when you're creating an app for a phone or a tablet, you have so much screen estate. Here it's a really small screen that's overlaid on you. You can't have too much graphics, not too much battery intensive stuff. So it's more of the UX and what do you plan to do with the app type of deal.
With the space, that's pretty cool. Let me get my man back there, he's hidden in the corner.
Who?
Oh, I'm gonna get you. You got your finger up. Oh yeah, you.
Oh, yeah. I'm just wondering, do you see any specific thing that Google needs to do with Glass before they go to market?
So right now, if you've analyzed the way Google releases products, they usually do it in-house when employees just have a fun project, a hackathon, if you will, and they say, oh, this is cool. Let's see what a very small group does. And then they expand and they expand. And sometimes after 2 years, they just say, okay, that's it. We're not going to do it. If they want to be successful, they really have to bring the price down, in my opinion. And they also have to create less hype, because anyone that wants to do a real business needs to know numbers. Right now, I honestly don't know how many active users Glass has, because it's not available, the number. So it's really a gamble. I estimate it to be 50,000. It could be easily 500,000, easily. I just don't know. So if they really want to have an ecosystem that supports businesses, you have to have the numbers, you have to have the analytics, I have to know more about the platform to really invest, because right now I'm a student, I can afford to work on something like that. When you're a business and it's investors' money at stake, you don't want to mess that up.
That's true. That's good, Chuck.
Is Google really the pioneer right now in wearable technology, or is there any inclination if the government or military is kind of utilizing wearable tech as well?
So in any technology, the military is usually ahead of the curve. A HUD display was really, those fighter jets, the pilots have it on their helmet. So most likely the inspiration came from there, and I'm pretty sure the military can shoot around a corner without looking around the corner. Google Glass is nothing fancy for them. What it does is it gives common people like ourselves those high-tech devices. So all of a sudden, you're really putting these cool things that people have never imagined in their hands for $1,500 and go imagine. The military, quite honestly, I don't think they can come up with as many ideas as all of us. So that's the benefit of such a device.
That's true. Regulations. Yes.
I'm just curious with Glass. You know, I'm on my phone almost all the day, just plugging in, doing different things, and I get tired of it. By the time I get home, I'm ready to throw it away. So how does Glass, I mean, do you think you're on it more? Does it, are you plugged into the technology more with it, or are you able to dismiss it unless something comes up?
I'm going to pause for that train, otherwise it might just blow its horn again.
This is where we all just kind of start singing Kumbaya. Y'all ready? Yeah, I didn't know about this part, but I'm just going to throw it in there. Y'all ready? I'm just kidding. If y'all start that, I'm running.
So usually they blow their horn. But I think what I've noticed with Glass is that anytime I pick up my phone, the micro interaction is really a macro. I don't even know that exists, that term. But just unlocking the screen, putting a passcode, then looking for the app, then clicking it, I mean, it takes so much time just to get to our task. And then all I want to do is retweet, right? Honestly, like it takes me so long just to do something simple. And obviously that will improve. But when you're on Glass, I can do this. Okay, Glass, take a picture. I just took a picture. Done. I'll take a picture of everyone and I won't. Well, it's not spying. You guys are you guys are on camera.
Yes, there was.
But
I'm just saying.
Okay, I apologize for spying on you guys. But it's really the interaction with those devices is much shorter. So your effectiveness is increased. So that way you can stop messing around with your phone so much and just do what is important, right? If you want to share a picture on Instagram unfortunately doesn't have an app yet. If you want to share a picture, just share it and you're done. You don't even have to grab your phone in your purse or pocket. It's just right there.
Wow. So you just said that Instagram doesn't have an app for...
Someone needs to call them up and...
I mean, come somebody on, this just is like a perfect image sharing device. Can somebody in this device? Room just go ahead and create that? Jesus. Yeah,
frustrates
that's just
me.
An idea. I don't know. Just share a picture. Instagram.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway. Instaglass. Who just named it? I'm stealing that.
Yeah.
Write that
yeah.
down. Instaglass. Right. Go ahead. I'm getting it now. Go get the domain right now, Jason. Instaglass. Okay, go ahead.
You kind of have graphically intensive apps just because of the nature of the battery. Whereas a lot of the apps that I use personally are really text intensive. Are there any examples of like text, given how small the screen is? I've never, I don't know if how, like the aspect ratio or whatever makes it feasible to read things.
So anyone that wants to wear it after this can wear it. Just FYI, it might take a while, but okay. text is really, the way Glass works is you don't want to have a novel on it, or you don't want to read really long emails. The way Glass works is you want to have glanceable information that is relevant at the right time. So it's about context, right? So if you have something that, hey, your car is parked here, or the meeting, you have to leave right now for your meeting, otherwise you won't make it. Those type of things is fine. Once you start writing novels and stuff like that, it's just too much. Emails, if you can read it, then you can always say, read out loud, and it'll read it out loud for you. And you can say, reply, and you can reply to it. So that's fairly doable. Anything a smartphone can do, the basics, it can do. When you get to the stuff that the smartphone is really good for, don't do it on Glass. If the smartphone shines at it, don't do it on Glass.
Good etiquette.
Can you shop it? I've never, messed with the Google Glass, but what has been in the Glass store the most useful app?
So, no. Honestly, there are more useful apps out there. I just don't have the means to do those. There are really two cool apps. One is Word Lens, and that is pretty much, if you look at a sign that has like foreign text, it translates it in real time and overlays it on your vision. So it can have German and you're seeing it in English or whatever your language is. And that is just amazingly powerful because that's augmented reality at its best. And then you have another one, which is a golf. I think it's golf site or something like that. And it'll show you the map of the golf course, where you are, your yardage. And it's just amazing. I don't know how to play golf, but if I knew, I would use it.
So I don't know how to play, but about these.
So it's pretty cool. Those two.
Cool.
I think.
Another question? There's another
there?
Question in the deep.
I think I have three.
You can only ask one. Yeah. I'm just saying. You can ask two.
All right, I'm going to wrap one. I'm gonna wrap
you
one.
Can do it.
Okay. First, what kind of privacy security concerns has Google Glass brought that didn't exist before? Second, what is Google doing, what is Google dedicated to doing to protect us from those privacy security concerns? And third is, what's been the most rewarding thing to you personally through the whole, this whole experience?
Okay, so the first question is, what kind of flaws can we see that Google Glass needs security for? Right? What kind of?
What new privacy security concerns does Google Glass bring that weren't there before?
I mean, anything with wearables is on a whole different level because if I can measure your heart rate, I can see what you're doing, I can hear what you're doing. I mean, some of them, Google is working on contacts that can know if you have diabetes. Like, that's a lot of data. So the real magic is going to happen when you integrate all that data and form a picture of a big picture view of yourself. But those companies have that. So if someone hacks into it, all of a sudden they know everything about you, even forecasting if you're going to get cancer at some point.
Oh, wow.
Right? So you have to be really careful. There's going to have to be some platforms along with those APIs that you bring out to access that information that secures really, really personal data. It's like having your social security out there. I don't know of any platform that does that right now, and I see it as a huge opportunity. I just don't know too much about security to do it.
But do you think Google's dedicated or at least shown some kind of interest to making sure that if your video feed in Glass is taken over or used in an app, you get some kind of notification? So, like the iPhone lets you know, or any phone lets you know that, you know, this app is getting your geolocation data.
So as secure as Android is, that's how secure Glass is right now. And I'm assuming they're going to add some unique tools to protect that more of a context data type of thing. I imagine they're working on it. It just hasn't been released. But imagine this. Glass has been out for 2 years and really in the public for a year. So it really takes time. I mean, iPhone, first off, it didn't have many apps. It was very, you know, basic. Yeah. And then your third question was... It, every day I'm surprised about how much I can accomplish if I'm just passionate. That's all it really takes, because some people say, you know, you're smart and you're dedicated and all that stuff. It really takes passion. If you set your mind to it, my fiance knows it. After she goes to sleep at 10, I come here to code and I stay long. Enrique knows it. So it's really about how much are you willing to invest. Besides your day job or your 9-to-5 or whatever, I think just the rewarding of, you know, if you're passionate, people will help you succeed. And I mean, Jake is standing right there. He's helping me with legal issues. Mike is helping me with business issues. It's just, and this is all for free. It's just remarkable how much support you get if you're just passionate.
I think we can end on that point right there. Clap it up. That was huge. That was huge. That was huge, brother. That was good stuff. So how many people in this room got a lot out of what Ryan was talking about up here? Raise your hand. Yeah. That was really, really awesome. We've had some really, really good, you know, Startup Grind events, but I can honestly say that this event is a little bit different in the sense that, one, leading up to the event, there was like a ton of hype. Like, Twitter blew up. We had whole conversations on wearable tech. On Twitter. If you're on Twitter, make sure that you're following Startup Grind and Startup Grind TLH for Tallahassee. And follow this guy.
Ryan,
I mean, because... Yeah, Google him up. Get on Twitter. Hook him up. And so there was a lot of momentum leading up to it. But another thing that made this one really, really interesting is that your depth or your understanding of your craft, and you're on the bleeding edge. I mean, you're talking about stuff that, like, when we talk about Google Glass... Like you said, there's not even that many people who even have it yet, and you're already developing for it, and you really made a strong point to say it's worth learning. Mm-hmm. I think that's powerful. So if I have to walk away with anything, I'm walking away with that, and I know the whole Startup Grind community worldwide is going to walk away with that. It's worth learning. So I want to go ahead and clap it up for you one more time. One more time. Yeah. Good stuff.